Thank you very much for this beautiful introduction. My lecture will be an epilogue to the introduction. I also have to admit that I still I'm centered at this book, Florence and Baghdad, which was published 3 years ago, and which is due to appear in English this year at Harvard University Press, and in Gallimard in French. But in Harvard University Press, it has a new subtitle. The new subtitle is Renaissance Art and Arab Science. So nobody knows how these strange links come about. I will start with upwarming, with some examples, before I will present you three parts of my talk. The first part is reminding you of Renaissance perspective as a Western invention which we still operate today. The second will be Arab optical theory and what it has to do with Renaissance art. And the third will be picture or geometry of light. I am not an expert for law questions, but maybe the legal condition and the cultural role of pictures will be possible to be narrated at this beautiful institute. I show you first a souvenir stand in Istanbul, which is divided in two parts. And you will immediately see that there will be two types of clients. The one is interested in the left part, and the other is interested in the right part, but not in both parts. So in order, I could give a lecture on this alone, but it is just to remind you that we are here concerned with two visual cultures whose relation is quite complex. Second, if we go to Spain, we find in religious imagery a kind of extravagancy which we do not meet in the rest of Europe. I am a picture theorist, but I must say in Spain I am slightly embarrassed to see that pictures are transgressing the borderline between what a picture is and what reality is, with real hairs, real clothes. So there is a kind of radicalism of pictures which must have an address. And this is in Spain another address, of course, than in the rest of Europe. The Spanish address could be illustrated by this picture from a Topkapi album of architectural drawings, which show us that here the emphasis is not on pictures in our sense, but also not on anything which is not pictorial, not imaginary, but which is regarded so far as ornament. Ornament is a Western term and probably does not meet quite what the mathematical precision and excellency of this type of representing the world, representing the light, we will come back to this, is about. When Western people visit Spain and go to the Alhambra, they, for instance, like this Englishman in the 19th century, he represents, he illustrates the building, and there is some fuss, some a little bit decoration around, which he was not so interested to really represent in detail. It is, of course, he did not expect something which is now recently, which has recently come to light, namely three Spanish mathematicians are decoding the mathematical law, which have been applied in the Alhambra. The logo of my book, which was published 3 years ago, was a manual for ceramics. And as you can see, it gives a choice in 16th century Italy, namely, either you buy ceramics with trophy, or you buy ceramics with rabesque. And rabesque is arabesque. Of course, again, a Western term. And with a long history behind, it did not start in Arab culture very early. I was concerned in my enterprise with two visual cultures linked by the same perception theory, even called both in both cases perspectiva. What I see as the relation between the one culture and the other is, in one case, in the Arab case, we have visual theory. How do we see? How do we perceive? In the other case, we have pictorial theory. How do we illustrate what we see? And there is a really interesting relation between the one and the other. In the West, in order to bring it to one short remark, the question is about seeing in images which can be reified in pictures. You know, the English language has a beautiful distinction between images and pictures. But here, I think it is of course that Arab people see images, but they often do not feel the need to represent these images as pictures. So this was just for a little bit warming up. Now, the first part will be very short. It will only be a reminder what perspective, Renaissance perspective, has been and how it can be summarized in the context of my talk. Perspective was the most important Western invention for picturing the world. It meant the installation, the legitimation of the individual subject via his gaze or conquering the world with one's own eye. It meant objectifying subjective sight. And here I have no need to go into depth, but it's a reminder what perspective has been and how it has been globalized. It has been globalized by Christian missionaries and then by colonial people, first in China in the 17th century already, then in India in the 19th century, colonial time, and in the Arab world in the 20th century. Al Jazeera and the TV pictures are also an outcome of this complex situation between perspective and its globalized and colonized form. You see here a Japanese woodcut. And this woodcut is interesting insofar as it applies the perspective only to architecture, but not to the people, because it doesn't see the relation between the one and the other. I show you very familiar sites on Urbino cityscapes, the cityscapes designed in the 15th century for the Duke of Urbino. He ran such a small dukedom that he wanted to at least see in pictures what could be his empire. And so he made painters paint a great empire of sight. The world as stage and visual architecture of perception. So this is also slightly ironical because perspective works in architecture better than in people. Now, the interesting thing about perspective is that we look at pictures which can look back, which allow an exchange of glances. So for instance, Here we have one of the traditional scenes in Florence, the Annunciation to Zachariah. But the really interesting thing are the Florentine citizens, which are invading the picture and which have otherwise nothing to do with the picture, except that they wanted to be in the picture. And if you look at them more closely, you see that they are all distinguished by their clans. There is not a single duplication of one clan of another, because they all have their usual clothing. They are uninteresting in what they are as a staged person, but they are very interesting how they see and how they relate to the beholder. So there is actually something, the most important thing is, as has been said beautifully in the introduction, the gaze. Now, the perspective enterprise or project soon culminated in the modern stage, the theater, or the prospect, the stage as prospect, or as we can say in German, the Schauspiel auf der Bühne, became the very incorporation of perspective. So the perspective was not for representing or painting the world, but also for performing the world on the stage in such a way that every visitor thinks it is his own view with which he sees the world. And in order to go one step further, you see myself from the back, and I look at two women, two Spanish women, and this is actually something which is meant by the picture. But if you go in a museum and read Murillo, you don't think about it, what it really means, that it is an encounter at the window. Now, the first theoretician of perspective was Leon Battista Alberti in Florence. You see a medal with his emblem. And what he chose is quite interesting. He chose the isolated eye. And the isolated eye was before the privilege of God himself. So he chose it in order to explain what his enterprise actually was about. But since he only had a human eye, which was not absolute and could not be omnipresent, he adds something to it, namely wings. The human eye needs wings in order to go from one place to another, while God, the divine eye, is everywhere present. So it needs wings in order to see the world step by step, flying and adding one side to the other. In that case, he made a distinction between the divine eye and his own eye, the anthropomorph, the anthropological enterprise. And of course, he added quid tum from a play of his, which could be translated as, what now? What shall we do next? When we pretend to understand the world by seeing it ourselves. So this is just a reminder what perspective was about, and very brief. Now, in the second part, I would like to introduce, as I did in my book, Alhazen ibn al-Haytham, an Arab physicist and mathematician who actually, and this was absolutely, I think, unexpected, at least in cultural theory and cultural science, he invented the system, the mathematical system, to do perspective. I will be also very short. We can discuss it later in the part. And this Alhazen, you see an Iraq banknote, which shows him. He was translated in the 13th century into Latin, and then in French, and then in Italian. So also the Italian painters, the Florentine painters, knew his book in translation. But then when he was printed in 1572 with a commentary by Frederick Riesner, the editor made an important change. He changed perspective into optics. And from that moment on, it was forgotten that everybody knew two types of perspective. The one, natural science, theory of perception, Arab, and the other, pictorial theory of artists who wanted to represent the world. And therefore, you know, both words are ancient. This is, of course, optic is Greek, perspective is Latin, looking through. But here you see ended the consciousness that perspective had a purpose which was twofold, explaining vision or perspective, vision or perception, and making pictures of it. Now, Alhazen was even very present in 17th century science and was overcome by Kepler, by Descartes, slowly, but they still started all from him. And there is a book on selenographia, namely description of the moon by Hevelius, which links him to Galilei. To the left you see the Arab, and to the right you see Galilei with the telescope. So that is how 17th century understood it. The invention of telescope and other inventions, anatomy, enabled the 17th century to go beyond Alhazen. Alhazen, here in an early manuscript written in the 11th century Arab world, he made an important statement which was illuminating for me. The statement runs as follows. The eye receives optical stimuli, receives visual forms, species. But then, via the optical nerve, these optical stimuli come to the brain. And in the brain, that is the place where pictures, where images exist. So it is not in the eye, but in the brain, which today, in the period of neuroscience, is evident. But at that time, there was a division between Western and Arab relation to this topic when the Florentine and other Western theoricians like Alberti and painters like Brunelleschi and others started to represent pictures which they think are in the eye and therefore can be represented also in front of the eye. So it is not about images, but about pictures. The reification of vision by pictures, which are the difference between the one and the other. The translations of Alhazen in the 14th and 15th century, you see a beautiful manuscript in Latin from a French center, are accompanied by all these geometrization, visual rays as transmitter of light via the rays of the light at a given eye angle. Geometry is a system of understanding how visual forms, species, are transmitted into the eye. Alhazen also was the inventor of the camera obscura. Now, this was surprising to me when I came across this evidence, because I had thought that the camera obscura was invented by 17th century Western scientists. But he made a very different use of it, and this is interesting. He used the camera obscura as model of the eye. So the camera obscura is how the eye functions when the light enters. dark box, clavier obscura. But then he was not interested that it produced pictures, reversed pictures, mirror-like, in the camera obscura, but he only wanted to study the light, the morning light, for instance here, the moonlight entering the camera obscura, entering the eye, and he wanted to understand the entrance and reflections of the light. I show here a photograph by a German photographer, Ursula Schulz Dornburg, who in her photographs represents architectural space as a camera obscura, in that she concentrates on light source and light traffic in a closed interior. You see, I only mention briefly topics which can be elaborated further in the discussion. Now, in the third part, I would like to hint at least to the question, what does this part of perspective or perception theory have to do with geometry and with all that which was normal in Arab culture to be represented? Now, as I have not yet shown in the book enough, but which has become more clear to me in the meanwhile, is that the so-called geometry which you see in the ultimate sense represents the traffic of light in the world, in the world of bodies, projected on a flat surface, like in this case, an architectural drawing scroll in the Topkapi Palace in Istanbul. It aims at representing the cosmic spectacle of the immaterial light into a world of bodies, deviated in straight lines around opaque bodies or crossing semi-transparent bodies like water and mirrors. So actually, in the sense of this theory, the world is like a complex system of light rays which behave differently according to the degree of transparency or opaqueness which they deal with. But they are never stopped, but only are deviated or crossing directly. So it is the spectacle what happens between the light and the bodily world. Now, when we read Alhazen and his remarks on perception, he gives examples. And we would expect him, Alhazen, to give example from our sensuous world, how we experience the world. Instead, his examples are taken only from two realms. On the one hand, from geometry, and on the other hand, on writing. For him, writing and geometry are equivalent, have the same complexity, and the spectator is expected to decode the complexity in a geometrical pattern and also in writing, to understand the divine structure of the world via reading and seeing. Here you have a Quran school of the 13th century at Konya, and you see in part in the strips it is writing, and in part it is just geometry. But the question is not about writing, this is clear, but what about just geometry? What is it? Why is it equivalent to writing? In order to make it very short. Now, if we look at Arab interior spaces, like this one, this dome, we see that what they actually are, they are a camera obscura in architecture. It is the same project to represent the entrance of light in a dark interior. But he goes one step further in this case, because here geometry is parcelizing, is cloisonizing the traffic of light and giving it an order in which it unfolds. And here we are very close again to light rays and the traffic of light in the world. But the interesting thing is that in Arab geometry, which is very general, in Arab geometry there is one step further from projection on a surface. There is the so-called project of mukarnas, as you see here. And mukarnas are patterns in squinches which represent the transition from a flat surface to a three-dimensional surface. So it's actually the pattern from the flat surface is entering via cells, a three-dimensional surface, geometry is translated into space. Now this is, now we have arrived at this part, at a very difficult argument. But I wanted to pick out one example in order to make understand this better, what I'm talking about. And this is the window. I would like to explain the difference of two visual cultures via the example of the window. What is a window and what happens at a window? I show you here an example from Hassan Fathi, Egypt's foremost modernist architect. And you see the window receives the light from the outside and transposes the entering light via the window grid. So there is first this step, that the light is sheltered, is patterned via this geometrical invention. And then it is further on reflected in the space. The mirror of the window, if you like, as a migrating light during the hours of a day with the sun's movement, uses the window as the entrance of the light, but not for looking outside. And I show you two different views of the window, one in Western painting and one in Arab miniature painting, which are absolutely contemporary. You know, they are two or three years apart. And you see the Flemish painter, Petrus Christus, in a religious painting, The Dormition of the Virgin, represents one of those people, a servant to the apostles. He is looking through the window. He uses the window in order to look outside where he is. Whereas, in the other case, a contemporary miniature of Bizard of Herat in today's Afghanistan is using the window as a screen of light which is behind the window. So it is not just a closed window. This would be not enough to say. But it is a window which screens off, shields off, or makes enter the light which has to come to the viewer instead of using pictures. You see here also the picture, picturing the world in one case. I think these two examples explain a lot. We can also discuss later on why there are suddenly pictures in Islamic art. They are late and they are always in books and never separated from text. And they have a specific influence. You know, there is a, one can absolutely explain how it comes to Arab miniature painting. Now, in order to ease the whole thing, and we can come back to this in the discussion, I will give an epilogue. One example, which I would like to call a Venetian at the Ottoman court. What does a Venetian painter do at the Ottoman court in 1480. I also would like to mention at least that I had a beautiful discussion about this topic with Orhan Pamuk at the Salzburg Festival 2 years ago. And I had read his novel, My Name is Red, in which he beautifully explains the role of pictures in his own visual culture. But I could not quote a novel in a scholarly work. So I had to find his sources. And it was, of course, very funny. He brought material, PowerPoint, with all his sources to Salzburg, but I had identified them. And so his sources were so meticulous that with his sources I could quote him. Not the novel, but the sources behind the novel. So here we have, what we have here is two times the same sultan, Mehmed II, the conqueror, in the one case painted by a Venetian, famous Venetian artist, Gentile Bellini, in November 1480 in Istanbul, as a panel. And the other, a watercolor, a miniature, a book miniature, by Sinan Bey, which represents a translation into the Turkish or the Ottoman custom of representing figures, and of course only the sultan. Now it is very interesting, and not by accident, that the panel picture did not survive in Istanbul, but was dismissed and found his way into the West. It is today in London. Whereas the miniature painting, which is based on it but completely changed, remained in Istanbul and is kept still in the Topkapı Palace, which is also a statement, I think. Now this is Gentile Bellini, outer portrait. Now, when he was in Istanbul, he did a lot of drawings of Yanichars, of servants, and they are, of course, all drawings, because he had two types of work. Either he made drawings, or he made oil pictures. Nothing in between. There is only one exception, which you see here, where he, on parchment, made a drawing of a Turkish colleague, which is represented in the act of drawing something, but in a miniature-like, beautiful, you know, I have a better picture here. And he did two things. First, he applied a technique he would never have applied in Venice. And this is obviously a reaction to his new context. Second, he represents a slave. You see it, his earring. This is the member of the Ottoman court, of course not a slave with lower services. He was an artist or scribe who is represented here. And he did something for which lacked any precedent in Ottoman culture so far. Actually, his choice of subject, on the one hand, and his way of doing it. And this was respected so much that it was added later, a long inscription, which you see, which is not from Bellini, on the right, say, and it says, "This is the work of Ibn Muazzin, one of the famous masters of the Franks." So don't ask me why he says Muazzin, but this is what it says. But it is a later inscription, and one of the famous masters of the Franks. And this sheet was kept in the Topkapı Palace, but was smuggled out by an American dealer in the 19th century, and today is in the Isabella Gardner Museum in Boston. Now, this is not the end of the story. The story continues, because this miniature was copied A first copy is in the Frier Gallery in Washington. A Turkish copy, which translates the language from the Venetian miniature into a new visual language. You see it, it's so evident that I have not to describe it. But he also did something which is very remarkable. He added a handkerchief. And that means this is no longer the slave, but he is an authority, maybe a ruler, or a poet. And a poet, this is now very clear, we see in a copy of the copy. So this picture migrates to Persia, India. Here you have a Mughal painter who copies mirror reversed the model, which is ultimately stemming from the Bellini miniature painting. And actually, you will be interested to know, is in the newly opened National Museum of Kuwait. Also interesting. Now, mirror reversed has many poets, many meanings, and a lot of to do with the traffic or transmission in visual cultures. And there is a beautiful book by Michael Barry, a big book of 2004, which explains that this is a mirror of the heart, that here what we really wanted, what he wanted us to see, is the bride of the poet, his heavenly model. So it's about poetry in painting. And this is all. Thank you.